introduce myself. My name is Amber. I have a podcast about cosplay called CosPod. You can find us at cospod.org, and I am addicted to cosplay. How many of you guys are wanting to get into cosplay? All right. So I should see almost every single hand up, because theoretically that's why you're here, right? You want to learn how to do first cosplay. There are three different ways that you can actually acquire your first cosplay. You can either buy it outright, you can have someone make it for you, or you can do it yourself. And that's kind of on the spectrum of you having to do more and more work, which may seem like a daunting task. Because cosplay really is time consuming. It takes forever. If you talk to some of the people at the cosplay contest on Saturday and you say, how long did it take you to make that costume? It's not unusual for them to say 8 months, a year, 2 years. It's not unusual. It really does take a lot of time. When you have a full-time job and you have those little 2 hours at the end of every night to craft, you're crafting like a madman, believe me. I do apologize in advance. I have notes I'm consulting, because heaven knows cosplay is an art, and there are 10,000 things to know about cosplay, so I will try my best to do this right, to do it justice, because cosplay deserves justice. Alright, so the first thing you can do is you can buy your costume outright. How many of you guys have been to something like Party City, Halloween stores, Spirit, Walmart? Usually around Halloween. Okay, so you've seen that they sell a pretty wide variety of costumes, mostly superhero, movie, that sort of thing. Things that are popular and people would know. So if for some reason you find yourself needing a costume right now, you have this Halloween party in 2 days, you have nothing to wear, you have to have a costume, that's where you go. Or if you don't have the money to acquire one via commission, or if you don't have the resources, there is nothing wrong with going to the store and buying your costume. There's a couple things that you should think about when you're buying your costume. The first is that you should read the reviews of the person selling them. Yeah, some retailers like Walmart take the reviews with a grain of salt. We all know everybody hates Walmart, everybody hates Party City. Take them with a healthy handful of salt. You want to read the reviews both for the costume itself, for those who have bought it before, because you want to know, hey, is it a good quality costume? You know, does it suddenly break down 2 hours after you wear it? Does it last for a while? Is it comfortable? But you also want to know about the retailer. Are they a good quality retailer? Do they ship on time? Because that's really important for conventions. You have a deadline. Is it a good quality fabric that it's made of? Is it a good price? Are they charging you an arm and a leg for something that's made completely of really cheap vinyl that's going to break? So you do want to make sure you pay attention to other people who have bought it and are telling their experiences about it. Something to be aware of, do read the reviews, don't just glance over them, because some companies are actually paying people now to write reviews. So you'll see this really glowing review like, oh, this costume is so awesome, and this retailer is so great, it was cheap, and perfect experience, 5 stars, 100%. Somebody probably paid them to write that. You don't have to look for things like spelling errors, but generally if you read a review, you can tell if someone's being genuine about it, because they'll give constructive feedback, and that's something that you look for in cosplay. You want them to tell you what's wrong with it if there's something wrong. If there's something great, you want to know about it, so that it's something to pay attention to. Also note, if you purchase from online retailers, because there are now a lot of costume houses that sell online, Cosplay House, Moon Costumes, Happy Cosplay, you can still purchase from them. Don't be afraid to buy from overseas. Just do note the location, because if you've ever bought something from overseas, it can take up to 3 weeks to a month to get through customs. That's a long time if you've got a costume convention in 2 weeks. So it is something to pay attention to. Some of them will offer express shipping. You're going to pay a lot more for that express shipping. It can be worth it. It's just something you need to pay attention to, is from where it's coming. Also, when you do cosplay online, make sure you pay attention to sizing. An American 10 is not the same as a UK 10. They do sizing a little bit differently overseas. Sometimes they'll just give you the measurements, say in inches or centimeters. Make sure that when you take your own measurements, compare them, make sure you buy the right size. Because this actually goes for patterns, too. When you purchase patterns for these costumes online, they'll tell you what sizes it's for in the corner. I have bought a kid's Sherlock Holmes pattern before because I wasn't paying attention. And kid's Sherlock Holmes costumes are about yay big. And I was making a commission for somebody bigger than me. So it is something to pay attention to whenever they list the size. Make sure it's adult if you're buying for an adult. Make sure it's kid if you're buying for a kid. When you purchase the costume, or you ask them about it, ask for a photo that is of the costume itself, not what they call a stock photo, which is something like this. If you see this and they're trying to sell you this costume, it may not actually look like this when you actually get it in the mail. So don't be afraid to ask them to take out a camera, go to the costume, and actually take a picture of it so that you know exactly what you're getting. You need to know exactly what accessories you're getting. Does it come with a wig? Does it come with the belts? That sort of thing. Which is important to know in case you have to go out and buy those things by yourself. Also note the materials used. I don't believe they're legally obligated to tell you what it's made of, but it can certainly help to ask them, is this 100% cotton? Does it shrink? Shrinkage is very important. This is a family-friendly podcast and panel. Don't go into the gutter. It is important to note, though, so if you have things, if you are allergic to certain materials, that's also very important to know. So ask them, what is this made of? What is the quality of it? What is the weave of it? Does it stretch? All of these things are really good things to ask. I know a lot of questions to ask somebody if you want to buy a $30 costume. But if you want that $30 costume to last you for a while, you really do need to ask the questions. Last thing about purchasing costumes outright is returns. My bit of advice to you is do not wear the costume and try and return it. They know. They know you have worn this costume and that you're trying to return it. So if for some reason you think you might need to return the costume, leave it unopened in the package. You can try it on if you want to, but you know, wear the proper undergarments, common sense sort of thing. Make sure you contact them first if you need to return that costume, because like I said, they do know. Some of them actually do charge restocking fees of up to 15-20%, so you'll have to give them back part of what you paid for that costume just for them to take it back. So this is why you ask all the questions up front, so you don't have to return it later. You're getting exactly what you're looking for. When you purchase on commission, this is basically where you ask somebody else to make a costume for you. This is mainly where you will start getting your costumes from, unless you want something from a movie or a superhero. When you do this, the same things apply. Ask all the questions. What materials are they going to use? How long is it going to take them? What are the shipping policies? If for some reason you're afraid that your costume is going to break in shipping, which, given our postal system, it can happen. It can happen. Things happen. Buy shipping insurance. It's really cheap. Just tell them how much you want to insure it for, and that will take care of things. Because when you ship props, it can be really important to have a very well-shipped package. You can negotiate with commissioners. This is something you can't do when you buy it online from a retailer. You can negotiate with commissioners on things like shipping, on overall price, on the materials they use. If you have something you want them to use specifically, say, I found this gorgeous fabric. I want you to make it out of this. You can ship it to them. Put it in a little box and say, here's the fabric I want you to use. Have at it. If you would like to negotiate on the total price of the costume, please remember that this is how these people make a living. Please don't stiff them on the cost of a costume. No one's going to make you a quality costume for $25 in 3 days. It honestly doesn't work that way. If you want a good quality costume, you're going to have to pay for it. This is how these people make a living. So please pay them a living wage so they keep doing it. Also, make sure that you communicate very clearly up front what you have in mind as your budget. Make sure you tell them, you know, I need it by this date, it is for this event, this is how much I can afford to pay you, this is what I want it made out of, here are any special requests. Like if you want pockets in the pants, pockets are really great things to have, and I lack them and I'm very sad. You can add other things, like if you want accessories, if you want to add rings to it, you can. Just make sure you communicate this up front with them so that you don't surprise them later on. They tend to get really upset when you surprise them later on with a special request. Oh, by the way, the con is tomorrow, and can I have this done in my costume? Don't do that, honestly. Likewise, if you want to have them ship it to the convention, you can do that. Check with the hotel first, because a lot of these big, bulky costumes and props can be kind of a pain to carry around. So you can actually tell them, hey, bring it with you to the convention. I'll pick it up from you there. After you've communicated directly with them, don't be surprised if you have to sign a contract. a lot of them will say, you know, here are my demands, or requests, I'm sorry, not demands. Here are my requests from you. Here's what you're going to do for me. Here's our agreement. Now, would you please sign? And be careful that you note, some of them do ask for a deposit up front. It can be up to 50%. Usually it's a little bit less than that, but that's basically to guarantee that you are committed enough to them to have them make your costume, and that you're not going to suddenly have them make it and then run with your money. Because let me tell you, most commissioners actually don't take refund requests at all. This is for two reasons. It's because, one, this is how they make their living. If any of you would be at work and some customer came up and complained and said, I hate this person, they're not doing their job, and your employer suddenly took it out of your paycheck, that would really stink. And it would hurt your budget a lot, because you have to buy things like food, you have to pay rent, you have to pay utilities. So that's reason number one. Reason number two is that it's really hard to sell a custom-sized cosplay on the internet. Not everybody is your measurements. It's really hard to find someone who looks exactly like you, because these costumes are made just for you. So if for some reason you don't want it, they're basically out of luck, because they can't resell it unless they find someone that looks just like you. So do think about that whenever you're commissioning costumes. It's probably a final deal.
Unless it's spandex
printed
by anybody.
I will not go into my spiel on spandex, because I have special feelings about that particular fabric.
She's not a fan of spandex.
And rayon and all the other knits. But safe to say, 99% of the time they don't take refunds. You have to resell that costume on eBay or Craigslist or something else. When you go to a commissioner to get a costume made, they're going to ask you for a bunch of measurements, minimum three, because most commercial patterns actually require three. That is the bust, the waist, and the hips. Sometimes they'll ask you for more. Some of them have standardized sheets now, and they'll have this really, really cool picture of some generic human like this, except theirs is normally much better than a stick figure. And they'll have little arrows pointing, and they'll say, I want your wrist measurement, I want your upper arm measurement, I want your waist, I want your bust, I want your neck. And they'll have little arrows pointing to them in a little line where you have to fill in here. Sometimes they'll ask you for up to 20 measurements, and it's a lot. But it's because they want to make a really fitted costume for you. So they need all of these measurements to be able to edit patterns. Patterns are infinitely editable. They're wonderful. So what you need to do, if you're getting on commission, is to get one of these. This is just a cloth tape measure, nothing fancy. You play jump rope with it. This is how you take your measurements. When you wrap these around your body to take your measurements, and I said this last year and I will say it again, please do it comfortably. This is how commissioners make your costume. If you want to be comfortable in your costume, you will take a comfortable measurement. If you want a really tight costume because you want to feel really good about yourself, you'll do it like this. And then you will promptly not be able to breathe at the convention. And you will probably keel over. So for that reason, you know, nobody else is going to see these measurements but you and the commissioner. So it's not like they're going to care what your measurements are. Give them accurate measurements, do it correctly, do it loosely and comfortably, because that's what they're going to use for your costume. A lot of patterns do have something built into them called ease, and all that does is it adds a little bit of measurement outside of the cutting lines of the pattern so that you can comfortably wear it, you can, you know, breathe so that your chest expands and the seams aren't all going to break. However, ease is usually only an inch, maybe two. So if you lie on this more than an inch or two, you're not helping yourself or doing yourself any favors. Now, if you change size before a convention and they're making a costume for you, that's okay. It's really okay. If for some reason you have something commissioned and then you have Thanksgiving dinner and all of a sudden your measurements change, that's okay. Just tell them. A lot of times, the people that you commission are competent enough, they can make adjustments in your costume. Worst comes to worst, they can start over if they have to. You may have to pay a little. But do tell them first, because chances are very good they can accommodate you. They can insert little expansion panels, or they can take in seams as you need it. They don't know these things unless you tell them. And as I was just telling these guys earlier, I made costumes for this convention in January. And then I spent 5 months losing 20 pounds. None of my costumes fit the way they were supposed to anymore, because it looked like I was wearing a balloon suit. And when you wear cosplay, you want to do cosplay justice. You want to have it look as good as it can on you. So you want it to be tailored for you, and to do that, you need to make sure that you're making it to your measurements. So if you change size, great, change the costume with it so that it looks right on you, and it doesn't look like you're wearing a balloon suit. Save to say, I should follow my own advice a little more often. Speaking of contacting commissioners, it's okay to ask them for updates. If you want to ask them for pictures, say, hey, how's it going? How's my costume coming? Can you show me what you've done so far? You can do that. You have every right to ask questions. You can even ask them, do you have an ETA? Do you know when this is going to be finished? What, you know, are you on schedule? Things happen. You know, people may end up having a baby. They may end up having a family emergency. Things happen where deadlines change. So feel free to ask them. Say, are you still on schedule? Just don't pester them every 4 hours with an email saying, are you done yet? Are you done yet? Are you done yet? How about now?
Yeah, it's like going down on a road trip asking, are we there yet? Are we there yet?
Yes.
Are we there yet?
Commissioners don't want to hear this. They really don't. Because yours is probably not the only commission that they're working on. And the other people are probably also asking, are you done yet? Are you done yet? So there's not a hard and fast rule for asking, are you done yet? It's use common sense, don't pester them. Maybe every couple of days, maybe once a week. You can ask them, say, how are things going? When you send them photos for the commission, what you need to hopefully give them are 3 shots, one of the front, one of the side, and one of the back of the character. This can be fan art if you wanted to. It doesn't have to be a screenshot. It doesn't have to be an actual photo. You can send them, you know, movie shorts if you want to. This is just to give them an idea of what the costume is supposed to look for. And if it has intricate designs all over that you want them to accommodate, they need to know what it looks like from all angles, because they're going to, you know, make their own sketches and make sure and say, okay, well, this stripe needs to wrap around here. This is where the seam needs to go, so that it looks accurate. So give them accurate information. They'll give you an accurate costume. But preferably, if you can't give them that, because I know some video games only give you get the front, and that's it. Or if you give them a reference shot from a movie, you get 1 shot, and that's it. Just give them 1 full body from the front at the minimum. If you can give them others, that's great. If not, at least give them that. And if there are customizations you want on the design, make them little notes. They won't be offended if you ask things. They don't have to tell you yes, but you'll never know if you don't ask. Thank you. I appreciate that. When you're commissioning props, you can ask somebody, say, hey, can you make me this katana from Bleach? Or, hey, can you make me this gunblade from Final Fantasy? Fantastic. 2 things to research first. The first one is state laws on weapons. Some states will say, well, you can only have these in certain places. If it's real, you can only have it in certain places. Particularly with guns, City of Dallas has specific laws about what kind of guns you can have, even if they're toys. Just look it up and make sure that you can have it, because it would be really bad if you spent all this work on this really awesome prop and then you can't carry it. So do check state laws first. The other one is to check convention rules. Some conventions are only allowing certain types of materials to be used now for props. You can only use things like soft woods. You can't use anything like shellac on them anymore to make them hard. You can't use metal rods up the middle for stability for things like swords. It's good to tell the commissioner that before they actually try and do that and then ship it to you. You go, oh, this is great! And then the convention security staff says, oh, no, you can't have that. Take it home. You have this really cool prop that you get a picture of, essentially. So do check to make sure you can actually have this really cool thing with you. After all is said and done, and you have your really great costume from the commissioner and all your props, leave them feedback. Just as you read the reviews from all of these other people to do your research, they want to know how they're doing. If there's something that they need to do better, if they need to be better on their shipping times, or if they're not charging the right price, tell them, because they may not know that. And also, everybody else who wants to buy a costume from them is looking at your feedback so that they know what kind of experience you had. Something to keep in mind when you're writing your reviews. Your review says just as much about you as it does about them. So please be polite, be kind, be constructive. You don't have to be effusive over them, but do be respectful and civil whenever you write your reviews. So like I said, people know who you are too. All right. Making sure we've actually already covered all of that. We are flying through this. Patterns. For making your own costumes, you will probably need a pattern of some sort unless you're really good at winging it. And frankly, I'm not very good at winging it. Now, you can either buy them or you can make them. Either way, both are equally just as good. Some people are better at one or the other. Frankly, I suck at draping costumes. So I always use these nifty things. These are commercial patterns. You can buy them at any sewing or hobby store. They are wonderful. You can get them as cheaply as $1. Because they run on sale constantly. If you watch your ads, they will say, hey, you can buy butter at 5 for $5. Yay! And then you buy a whole bunch of patterns and you stock up because you will use these over and over and over again, despite the fact that they are made of tissue paper. If the costume is for you, it's best if you fit the pattern to your body as opposed to on a dress form. Unless you have the perfect proportions of a dress form. Dress forms are only going to kind of approximate it, which is fine. It just won't fit as precisely on the dress form as it does on you. Just make sure you remember where you stuck the pins whenever you try and put the item on yourself, particularly when you are fitting pants.
It helps to have a friend in that case.
I speak from experience, and needless to say, I am more careful now. Also, it's helpful to have a magnet hanging around so that if you drop pins, you can find them. Just stick the magnet on the end of a stick and pretend like you're metal detecting them. Because you really are kind of metal detecting. You can go find your pins. Because finding them the other way, which is to take off your shoes and walk, it is most unfriendly to one's feet.
I would rather attach magnets to your shoes.
Well, you could attach magnets to your shoes, but pins can still stab the bottoms of your feet, which is why I suggest using a stick.
I remember you mentioning this, something about this last year. The duct tape dress form, made yourself.
Yes.
I do not remember whether you said that was a fantabulous idea or the worst thing ever.
Both. As is the answer to all things in cosplay, both. This is because duct tape dummies have one major upside and one major downside, and so do regular dress forms, oddly enough. Duct tape dummies are fantastic if you are fitting it to yourself and yourself only and you never change size. Because duct tape dummies, you basically take an old shirt and two rolls of duct tape and you make yourself a mummy for a day. And then you ask a friend with scissors, it has to be a friend because you don't want your enemy holding scissors near you. And you ask them to cut you out of it and then you tape it back together and you stuff it and that's your duct tape dress form. So it stays one size the whole time. The one major downside to those is that you can't really stick pins in them very well. Ever tried sticking pins through duct tape? It does not work terribly well. You get nasty adhesive stuff all over your pins afterward. So that's the major downside to duct tape dummies. So basically the reverse applies to standard dress forms. They'll take pins, you can fit to them, but they don't fit you unless you happen to have those perfect proportions. Yeah, dress forms do have dials where you can change the size. But they're only sizes within about a half inch. So you get like 37, 37 and a half, 38, 38 and a half. If those aren't your measurements, well, you get to approximate. Which you do a lot of in cosplay making anyway. You do a lot of approximation. But that's not what you want to do if you don't have to. On a side note, dress forms are expensive. Duct tape is cheap. Duct tape is like $3 a roll. Granted, it does take a lot more labor because it takes a couple hours to stick you in duct tape and then somebody has to cut you out of it, or if they're really mean, they'll make you wear it. Dress forms will generally run you between $100 and $175. That's without shipping. So, yeah, they are kind of expensive, but if you're looking to go into business for yourself or if you want to make costumes for your friends, that's where dress forms really shine because you can change the measurements on them. So you can change it. You can do stuff for yourself. You can change the measurements to your friend's measurements. Or if you have someone you're taking commissions from, you can do it for that instead of having them mail you a duct tape dummy, in which case you get a collection of duct tape dummies. So that's kind of the major advantage and disadvantage. They're both good. It depends on what you're doing with them, as in all things with cosplay. When you fit the test pattern to yourself, wear the undergarments you're going to wear with the costume. This is for fitting purposes, because yes, we hope you will wear undergarments when you actually wear the costume. If you're not, don't tell us. Also, when you fit it, make sure that you walk around, jump, do your action poses, do whatever it is you're going to do in the actual costume, so that you can get a feel for what the costume will actually tolerate. If you can't run around and you try it and something breaks, then you know you're going to have to make adjustments to your costume. Biggest thing to remember whenever you're fitting your costume, make sure you can sit down and go to the bathroom. This is really important. I actually learned this last year. For those of you that saw me on the stage, I was in full body armor. I could not sit down for 5 hours because I did not design it with that in mind. It also meant I couldn't use the restroom. So it is really important to think about these things that you are going to do in your costume, because it's just like normal wear. This isn't like the anime or the movies where they never have to go to the bathroom or they never have to like drive a car. We have to do these things in real life, and so you kind of need to design your costume thinking about those things in mind, because you're going to have to do them unless you can hire someone to do it for you. Which,
whatever you want, because you're insanely rich.
Yes. Well, if you are also insanely rich, that is helpful in cosplay, because cosplay requires a lot of money and a lot of investment.
Yeah.
Speaking of investment, when you want to make a really neat costume that you see online and you have no clue where to start, the internet is your friend.
It's everyone's friend.
Normally it is everyone's friend, and the internet is also for something else, but this is a failure. Don't be afraid to go on YouTube with Safe Search on and research this costume if you want to see, you know, I want to make a Halo suit. Tons of people have made Halo suits. Google Halo costume on YouTube, and you will find videos of people telling you how they did it out of EVA foam. There's tons of tutorials. Also, if you see a cosplayer that you're really impressed with, and you say, you are the embodiment of this character, how did you do it? Cosplayers are generally not offended if you ask them how they did it. It's not a secret how we make these things. It's a bunch of materials and adhesives put together and a lot of sweat, blood, and tears. That's how costumes are made. So if you say, how did you do it? They'll probably be willing to at least walk you through the general process. I mean, they won't hold your hand and do it for you. But they'll give you a general idea of what it takes to make this costume. So, you know, don't be afraid to ask questions. Also, you can ask them what materials they used. If they have a specific tip or trick and say, hey, this material works better than this, because I've made this costume 3 different times, take their advice and pay attention to it. After you've done all of your research and you've gotten your things together, one of the best things you can do when making your own costume is to have a sketchbook. And this is not only for making art and stick figures, I promise, although that is fun in your free time. This is actually good for planning your costumes. What you do is you draw out the different parts of your costume and you make instruction notes. I'll walk this around, and you can see all the different little notes that I've scribbled on this. And this doesn't have to be neat by any means, because all this is it's a construction diagram, so that you know what the hell it is you need to be doing. This is actually for a costume I will be making next year. As you can see, I've actually already thrown out all the diagrams that I need to make this costume. This is also a good time to check the proportions. And unfortunately, in cosplay, this means you have to do math, and I am terribly sorry to make you do math, but this is one of the few times in your life when you say, when am I ever going to use this? Now. Now would be the time that you're going to use this. Proportions are actually really important, and it's not just for accuracy, but it's to make sure that parts hang correctly on you, especially when you're doing things like armor. Especially also if you're doing things like props. If you see that Cloud Strife carries a sword that's 2 times taller than he is, think about carrying a 12-foot sword around in your country. It's really important to properly get your proportions. So the first thing you need to do is find a full-body picture of said character. Chances are good it's really going to be about this big because it's going to be on a computer. Or it's going to be from a movie or something similar. If you can find a full body size picture, then you don't have to do any math. You just take a ruler up to the screen and measure it. But normally it's going to be, you know, yay big. What you do is you find the height of the character. And then you take your height, standing flat on the ground with those heels. Adding a couple inches to your height is not going to impress anybody. So once you have those two measurements, you end up setting up a proportion. And it has your height, and this is going to be the dimensions of the piece you're going to be making. So if you're making, say, a shoulder plate for armor, it's going to be the length of the shoulder plate. So then you compare, they've got shoulder armor, and I apologize for my horrible, horrible picture. Take the length of theirs. So character height, and then character armor. And you get to solve. Yay, algebra's fun! And you get to do this over and over and over again for every dimension that you need. You can literally end up with hundreds of little measurements if you really want accuracy. You don't have to use all of these. You can use guesswork on some of it if you want to. You don't have to measure how wide the borders are on their clothing. You could probably visually estimate that, or you can just make it up as your own measurement. If you want the borders on clothing, the bias tape to be 1 inch thick, have 1 inch thick bias tape. There's absolutely nothing stopping you. And if people sit there and make fun of you because, ha ha, your borders aren't the right accurate width, tell me. After you put all that effort into a costume and they want to make fun of this one little thing for accuracy, one, they're probably an otaku, and two, they really don't need to be making fun of you because they're not sitting in the costume. So, of course, you have all of your construction notes, including proportions, if you need them. And this is going to serve as your construction guide for your pattern. Now, most patterns actually do come with instructions, most of which will read like Greek, just because sewing is its own separate art that I won't really go into. But this is, again, where the internet is also your friend, because you can ask it what in the heck a French seam is. And you can ask it what it means when you say, sew this with a curved seam and notch. If you don't understand something in a pattern, it's best to check it first before you actually attempt it and try and sew it the way the instructions look like they're telling you to do it, which I have done many times. Sewing without instructions can certainly be an interesting experience. When you have your pattern, acquiring materials is going to take a little bit of legwork. Unless you order everything from the internet, in which case the legwork is going to your mailbox back. But something to look for in the stores is that some fabrics are seasonal. You're not going to find fleece and wool in the summer, just like you're not going to find swimsuit knits in the winter, unless you want a really chilly costume. But certain stores don't sell them at certain times. So if you need a costume in June, think about that when you're going out to buy your materials. Budget first. You're going to walk into the fabric store and see all these nifty little things that you think you needed that aren't actually on your list and you don't have the money to spend. Going to Joann's is a lovely experience if you have money. If you don't have money, it's a rather unpleasant experience because then I get to look at all the shinies that I can't have. You can also look for discount items. Feel free to go to Halloween stores the day after Halloween. They run really great sales. You can get things like wigs on discount. You can get accessories like jewelry. You can get boot covers. You can get all sorts of things. You can also go to commission or consignment stores. They have fantastic things. Antique stores. They've also got fantastic things at really fantastic prices, too. Costuming doesn't have to be the expensive art that we think it is. It's only expensive when you actually go out and buy the really nice fabrics and the really nice thread and the really nice sewing machine to do everything with. It doesn't have to. You can do things on the cheap and it looks just as good. I've seen pictures side by side. When you buy fabric, dye lots are very important. Does everybody know what a dye lot is? Dye as in D-Y-E, not as in dice you roll. Okay. Dye lot is when they take a whole swath of fabric and they dump it in a giant vat with coloring. And you dye the fabric a certain color. All of the fabric that is in that one vat is one dye lot. It means they dyed it all at the same time, and theoretically it should all be the same color.
Theoretically.
And then you go and buy the exact same fabric off another bolt. Different dye lot. Slightly different color. They may have left it in the vat for 2 seconds too long. That's all it takes. So when you buy fabric for a costume, if you think you might make a mistake, buy extra of the same bolt. Because that way you're sure that it's all the same color. Because it would really stink. I brought the trench coat last year where it was white on top and it was eggshell white on the panels on the bottom. And I didn't know it until I completely finished the trench coat and he walked outside. It was a commission too. And I didn't know it because I didn't pay attention to the dye lots. Exact same fabric, same barcode and everything. Two different dye lots, slightly different color. So do make sure that you look at the color. If you're looking for a specific color, take a swatch of fabric, just a little random piece of fabric, into the store with you and actually load it up. If you need to, you can bring a portable light that projects natural light so that you can see how it's going to look when you walk outside. Because that does tend to be really important. Make sure that your fabric is square, and all that means is to make sure that the fibers run at 90 degree angles, like this, so that they make squares. If your fabric is slightly off center, and you see the fibers doing this, your fabric is structurally weak and it's going to break. And when you're doing an action pose, having it break at the wrong time, no. You want to think ahead for this. You want your fabric to be square because this is the strongest that it will be so that it will last under stress.
Does that mean it's just a little bit more like elastic when it's at the 90 degree angle?
Every fabric has slight stretch if it is woven. The only exceptions to that are things like leather and vinyl. Those don't stretch. Every other fabric has slight give. And it will give evenly if it's like this. It will give unevenly like this. It's more of a science experiment when your fabric is off square. You don't know how it's going to give. It's going to, what is that, Murphy's Law? Anything that can go wrong, Bill?
Yeah.
This is Murphy fabric. This is square fabric. You want square fabric. And that is all I will say about that. You can square off the edges of fabric. If there's only a small portion of your fabric that's Murphy fabric, you can get one of these. This is a rotary cutter. Rotary because it's round. They're really nifty. And you can cut off, using one of these, the edge of the fabric that is not square. You can also use the edge of a table if you want to. You don't have to get fancy toys like this. But anything that is an exact 90-degree angle, you can use to square off the edge of your fabric and make sure that the fibers are where they need to be. Sewing machines. How many of you guys have a sewing machine? Wow, a good portion of you guys. You don't have to have one to make costumes. It does make it a lot easier. For the most part, there are some things that hand sewing is better. If you're doing very intricate work, if you're doing appliques, a lot of times hand sewing is better for that. But if you're under a time crunch and you have lots and lots of really straight seams, you get one of these. Unfortunately, I no longer have my Walmart beater because I actually gave that away last year to somebody who wanted to learn how to sew. And on a side note on that, if you guys ever end up with a sewing machine that you can't use anymore, please donate it. Don't throw it away. You know, give it to somebody who's going to use it because there are people like you out there who want to get into cosplay and can't afford a machine. So if you do get one, donate it.
Yes. We're selling on Craigslist. Right.
That's true. You can do it on Craigslist. I say be very careful on Craigslist, just for safety. Be very careful. Tell them. If not, you can donate it to a church. You can donate it to a hospital. You can also donate it to Veterans Affairs because there's a lot of women who make quilts for returning soldiers. They can use basic stitch machines for those, and they would be very grateful to have them. So if you have old ones, please donate them if you can't sell them, of course. Sewing machines are an odd breed. The only two things that you can really think about when buying a sewing machine is what is your budget and what are you going to do with it. Those are really the only two factors you need to think about when buying a sewing machine. It doesn't really matter how fancy it is, because you can buy an $800 sewing machine that does everything under the sun computerized. You can even like take a picture of the pattern, plug it on an SD card, and it actually sews the whole thing for you. If that's not what you need, don't get it, to be honest. It's a waste of money. If you only need, you know, a $100 machine, and this was a $100 machine, get that. Every machine has straight stitch. It'll stitch straight. If you're going to do any sort of seam work or zippers, you will probably need one that has a zigzag on it. I forgot my eraser. That would be very helpful. Most machines, modern, nowadays, have both the straight and the zigzag as a default. You'll find a lot of older machines, if you get an old Husqvarna or a Dressmaker or a White machine, a lot of them don't do zigzag at all. So you want a machine that for sure does straight stitch and that does the zigzag stitch. And you only need 1 foot for this, and all sewing machines come with it. If you want to do other nifty things, like roll hems, or if you want to do invisible zippers, they sell all sorts of nifty sewing feet for that. You don't need all of them, they're specialty items that you can add on. But they are really cool, and the nice thing about sewing is that all the accessories are named by what they do. So an invisible zipper foot is for invisible zippers. A zigzag foot is for zigzagging. Buttonholer makes buttonholes. So that way, if you know what you want it to do, go to the store and say, I want my machine to do this. They're going to point you to the notions wheel, and you're going to find the name of what you're going to do, and that's the foot that you need. Really helpful. If you do buy a machine, make sure that you maintain it. You're probably going to need something called sewer's oil. Do I have my sewer's oil? I don't have it. It's okay. All it is just a tiny, tiny little bottle of lubricant, family-friendly panel, that you put into your sewing machine that keeps the gears from locking up. Basically, it keeps everything running smoothly. Occasionally, you can take a can of air and just blow it out a little bit, make sure that all the fuzz and dust aren't in there. If you sew fur, you're going to have to clean out your machine every single time. I'm sorry. That's just the way it works. Any sort of napped fabrics, actually, this is really important to know. Between napped fabrics and not so napped fabrics, napped fabrics does not mean that the fabric is relaxed and taking a nap. It means that fibers are kind of like grass. This is the surface of a napped fabric. It just has little fibers that stick up. Some of them actually end up having full loops instead. You see this on like terry cloth. You have a bathrobe at home, you can pick it up and go, that's napped fabric. They usually all have a texture to them, and they also usually have a direction to them. If you smooth your hand across napped fabric, it will look different if you smooth your hand the other direction. And they'll look lighter or darker. That just happens to be the way napped fabrics are. If you use them for patterns, make sure that all your pieces face the same direction, because otherwise you're going to have this really cool patchwork light-dark effect all over your costume. If that's what you're going for, that's great. But otherwise, if that's not what you're going for, make sure all your pieces face the same direction going with the direction of the fabric. Also, maintain your general equipment. Sharpen scissors. Make sure all your needles are sharp. When needles go blunt, please do not just throw them in the trash. The trash man will find them the hard way. Put them into a little block of foam or wood, if you can find a soft wood, then dispose of them that way. Kind of like X-Acto blades. They have those little dispensers that you can stick X-Acto blades in. Same thing for needles. I'm sorry?
Wine corks.
Wine corks do work very well, or any sort of cork. You can go and buy those little rolled sheets of cork. Just please don't throw them into the trash. Same thing with pins. Stick them in something first so that the sharp, pointy end isn't going to stab the eye. There's a really quick and dirty way to sharpen scissors. It's best if you actually take it to someone who knows what they're doing and can sharpen it for you. It's really cheap. It's like $2 to $4. Of course, for that price, you get a new pair of scissors, too. But that's beside the point. You can take a pair of these and cut a few times through a sheet of aluminum foil. That will temporarily sharpen them. You can also do that with sandpaper. That is temporary. If you need your scissors sharpened, if they're really blunt, and these are actually blunt, then take them to a sharpener, or you can buy a scissors sharpener. The way you know if scissors are blunt is you take a piece of fabric, not paper, fabric, and you cut. If you cannot cut from the tip to the blade, then your scissors are dull. That's the really easy way to know. And it's important to have them cut all the way to the blade because sometimes there are precise cuts you need to make where you have to position the scissors just so, and they will cut the same way every single time. If they're blunt, then you don't always know how your scissors are going to cut. I've had that problem all year so far this year because I've been lazy and not sharpening my scissors. But do take care of your things.
Question on scissors, since you're talking about that.
Mm-hmm.
Not sure the reason why this is, but my mother and most of her sewing uses pinking shears.
Mm-hmm. Does anyone not know what pinking shears are? Mm-hmm. Okay, a couple. Pinking shears are like standard scissors, except the blade is a zigzag. So that when it cuts out little triangles in the edge of the paper. That's what pinking shears are. Occasionally, you can use them if a pattern tells you to notch a curve. You can cut with pinking shears, and it will effectively notch it for you. That's the easy, sleazy way to do it. But you can do it that way. You can cut with pinking shears, but I would also say not to do that on fabrics that ravel, because then that leaves an open edge for them to ravel. And you've got a cut that's right there next to the seam. So if it's a fabric that doesn't ravel, go for it. Raveling, maybe not so much.
Never ask for the logic on it. It just doesn't follow the pattern.
There's a lot of strange things that go on with sewing etiquette that I don't know about, and I don't ask questions because I don't want to know the answers to them. Most of them are probably far, far older than me. Hand sewing versus machine sewing. You can do both. Realistically, the only difference is time. Hand sewing takes a lot longer. But sometimes you don't have a choice. If the seams are too narrow, I had to hand sew a pair of gloves 4 times this year because the seams are so narrow that my sewing machine can't actually handle them. My sewing machine can't actually go that small. So I had to sit there and bag stitch the whole thing. And of course, I wasn't paying attention to what I was doing, which is why I had to do them 4 times. I made mistakes. I make mistakes like everybody else. Heaven knows I've never met the cosplayer who's perfect yet. If I do, I'll let you know. But until then, you're gonna make mistakes. Speaking of making mistakes, you get to make friends with this guy. I see everybody's met my friend. This is a seam ripper. This is very pointy. The reason it is pointy is because you slip it under a stitch, like so, and then you pull up, and it will tear the stitch out. And you get to do that over and over and over and over and over again to pull out all the threads when you make a mistake. Hence, seam ripper. Again, sewing tools are named by their function. This will be your friend because you will make mistakes. The only time seam rippers are not your friend is when you're working with light, delicate fabrics. Yes?
Oh, can't you just, like, maybe just rip out the knot a little bit and then try to pull it out, or is that too risky with fabric?
You can try that, but that's almost as bad as trying to rip between the two pieces of fabric instead of ripping from the top. The only reason is that you may rip a hole in the fabric that you then have to repair. And that just makes it structurally unseamable.
Even more work.
If you want to do it with manicure scissors, you can do that, and that way it won't tear the fabric. Just don't do it with one of these guys. Likewise, these are not the friends of silk, satin, velvet. Anything that has holes permanently torn in it, you don't want to use a seam ripper because you're just going to tear the fabric. Some of those fabrics are really light and delicate. And unfortunately with those, you have to do a lot of manual labor with manicure scissors. I'm sorry. Yes?
So what happens if you accidentally set the gauge too high and your stitch is super,
really
super tiny and your seam ripper does no good because you can't fit the big fat seam ripper?
You end up having two choices for that. You can find a smaller seam ripper.
They do exist.
There are multiple sizes of seam rippers, I will have you know. I have 3 different sizes of seam rippers. Your only other option is to do what you're never, ever, ever supposed to do on fabric. That's to take the two edges of your seam, two edges of your fabric like so, that are stitched together. You split them apart a little bit so that you see the stitching. You
take manicure scissors and you cut up the center. Very, very, very carefully. You're never supposed to rip up the center of your seam with the fabric split like that, because you have a tendency to rip a giant line all the way down your fabric where all your holes are. That's why you're not supposed to do it. But in that specific case, that's what you do.
Yeah, because I had some hands. And...
which I have done before. I have done what I say not to do before. Really quickly, pressing versus ironing. Everybody knows what this is, I assume. Everybody has iron clothing.
I hope.
I hope you have iron clothing at some point in your life. Of course, mine is also covered in water. I am very sorry. When you iron an item, it is full of water. You move it across the fabric, just like you would normally, ironing laundry or your clothes. This is not what you do to fabric when you are pressing to set something. When you set your seams, to press needs to go down, don't move it, up. That's all there is to pressing. It's really simple, I promise. But so many people, when it says, press seam open, they iron it open. It doesn't affect it so much on seams, it doesn't make as much of a difference, but when you're using something like stitch witchery, or some sort of fusible item where it specifically says, press down for 8 seconds, you can't iron those. It's going to move the resin around, the fibers, and then your fabric's not going to fuse correctly. So if it says press, please do. When it says iron, please do. So I did want to make sure to address that, because some instructions will specifically say that. Ironing, more or less, is for removing wrinkles and for setting pleats. Pressing is pretty much for everything else. Finish your seams as you go, if at all possible. If you have fabric that ravels, you can use a little bit of a fray check, which is a really nifty thing that they have. That basically, it's like a glue. It seals the edge of your fabric to make sure it doesn't tear open. If your seams start to ravel, gradually they're going to rip themselves apart. That's just the nature of fabric, unfortunately. Having non-raveling fabric is great, but most fabrics aren't that way. So if you can, make sure you finish off, make sure your seams aren't going to ravel. You can use the zigzag foot and zigzag over the edge of the fabric to hold all the fibers together. That will also prevent them from ripping. Basting. Basting is really important. Basting is not what you do when you make a cake. Other kind of basting. Basting is just holding two pieces of fabric together. Normally you do it with pins. I think that's normally what you think of when I say basting. But you can also use things like clothespins. You can use sewing weights if you want to. You can even baste with thread. Just make really long, loose stitches that you'll have to tear out later. Yes, I know, it's more work. But basting by thread is actually the most accurate way you can do it. I would say always baste in every single case. You may not be able to use pins with things like silk and velvet because the pins will leave holes. For those, use clothespins. Or you can baste with thread if you want to. Just think about the fabric, because whatever basting method you use, you're probably going to see the end result in your fabric. If you use clothespins, sometimes they leave impressions. I actually had a vinyl belt that I was wearing last year. I used clothespins to baste it. It had a really cool texture going along the top of it, because it left impressions every half inch or so where I had left them for basting. And I didn't realize they left an impression in the fabric. It looked really cool, but that wasn't what I had in mind, and it wasn't supposed to look like that, and I couldn't fix it. Yes?
What about things like the spray stuff?
You can use spray adhesives also. Make sure they are washable. And test them first, as with all things in cosplay. Test in an inconspicuous place to make sure it's not going to ruin the cosplay. Yes?
What about leather? Would that be in the same realm?
Leather is what I use clothespins on. Pins don't really work either, so I've pretty much found that the only way to baste pleather is to use some sort of adhesive.
I got a solution for you. White school glue. I have used it multiple times. You give it a couple of layers, and it is awesome on pleather.
It's some sort of adhesive. When you've gotten your basic costume together, then you can start assembling the other things like jewelry. Again, consignment stores and antique stores. You can find some really nifty jewelry that you can build on. And you probably won't find exactly what you're looking for unless somebody happened to donate their their licensed character-specific jewelry to a store. But otherwise, you can make it off of a base that you find somewhere else. I've made a lot of my jewelry this way. You can find basic bangles, basic necklaces, basic chains. You can also buy these things in hobby stores now. Joann's and Hobby Lobby now sell a bunch of jewelry. On wigs, you have to be really careful. This is an old Athena wig that I had. Netting is the important part. This is what netting looks like. Ooh, it's the inside of a wig. This has to be really strong. And yes, you should probably ask the wig maker what the netting is made of. The reason this is an old wig is because I brushed this wig to detangle it. The netting was extremely weak and I lost a quarter of the wig detangling it. That's why it's now kind of half poorly braided and I don't wear it anymore. This is kind of an example saying, don't do this! So do make sure that the netting is firm. If you can tug on your wig like so and fibers come out, your netting's not strong enough. You should be able to brush your wig with the correct brush, and you should only lose maybe 4 or 5 fibers. Not a quarter of the wig. Also, do ask them what fibers it's made of. Yes?
And what would be good for the netting to be made out of? What's the correct?
You probably want it to be made out of a polyester mix, maybe poly cotton, something that's tightly woven, basically, so that the hairs don't fall out, but that has a little bit of give so that it will stretch over your head. Because wigs are supposed to be one size fits all. That they're not always, because we all have different size heads. They're supposed to be one size fits all. But the fibers on the inside and the outside are important, especially if you're doing heat styling tools. You don't really want to set a curling iron to it if you don't know that you can, because then you won't have a wig. You'll have a bunch of melted plastic, which you can't use for anything else. So it is good to ask them, what is this made of? As with all things, what is it made of is the most important question. I believe that covers, yes?
If the netting is weak, what do you use to detangle it?
If the netting is weak, you can try a couple of things. I have been told that fabric softener can help. You can also use a mixture of watered down lotion. Basically anything that has a release agent. They'll tell you you can use silicone spray. For those who don't know, silicone spray is WD-40. Your wig is going to smell disgusting. You can use it. It's silicone spray. You can use it. Do it outside. Please, for the love of all that is holy, do it outside. But basically you have to find a release agent that will work on the fibers of your wig. Which sometimes you can find. Yes, real quick.
You said the right kind of brush.
Mm-hmm. You need to get a wide bristle brush for wigs, preferably with the bristles in parallel. So you can get like the round flat brushes that have the bristles kind of everywhere. You can't really use those because wigs aren't built the same as human hair. Bristles that are kind of everywhere are meant to pull out dead fibers in your hair, which is good for human hair because we want to pull out dead fibers in our hair. Brushes that have parallel bristles are meant to slide between the fibers of a wig, so it's less likely to pull them out. And that way you'll pull out the tangle, not the hair, which is what you want to do when you brush a wig. So just a really wide brush with parallel bristles, yes.
Would you be able to use it on the curly hair?
If it's wide-toothed. Even the wide tooth on one of the normal combs might be too much. You may need to get one of the picks. That's the word I was looking for. You may need to get a pick comb. And those are wide. That's actually what I use on mine. Well, I tried to use on mine.
It's been 10 minutes past.
I'm sorry. It's okay. I was finished up anyway.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
Thanks, guys. Sorry I had to cut a little.